بروفيسور سعد مهدي. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Tonight is an exceptional day, as Professor Mahdi he just said to us, because we are returning back to meet our great Professor Raafat Abdel-Azim. He is a professor in anesthesia, intensive care and pain management in Ain Shams University. And he was the first one who started this course. So it is a great honor for us to start with him a very important subject and very important series, of course, about the anesthesia ventilators. And this series will be extended almost about 5 weeks in progress. And I think all of us, we are keen to hear from our great professor about these subjects. Of course, I think the subject of the basics in anesthesia and especially in the ventilators and is very important. We are facing we are working with the ventilators every day, but we should know everything about the ventilator, even in the anesthesia or in the intensive care. So this basic science is very important, and all of us, even seniors and juniors, we should know a lot and in details about the ventilators, how to deal with the ventilators, the modes of the ventilators, the updates about the ventilators, the tests which needed to start with the ventilator. So all of this, I think, will, and I'm sure it will be covered in details and meticulously by our great professor, Raafat Abdel-Azim. So please welcome with me, with our great professor, and the floor for him now to start his series. Thank you, Prof.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Isam. Thank you, Dr. Saad. And I'm welcoming everybody here. Dr. Isam has summarized my introduction. Thank you very much. Of course, it is very important to know how to operate. These lectures are based on physics, our physical principles. It started as a part of or a topic of the physics course. So to understand anesthesia ventilators, we have to go every now and then to the physical principles. I'm trying to summarize or to simplify as much as I can the topic to understand how do they work. The anesthesia ventilators are of many types, as you know. The most commonly used type is the ascending velocity ventilators. I will explain why we called it ascending velocity, or we can call them the traditional ventilators. As we know, the Omida or the Pellon or Draeger or Datex Omida or General Electric all lie within one category of ascending bilious ventilators or traditional. We have some ventilators in which, in the previous one, we can see what we call bilious. The bilious moves up and down, and we'll know how this bilious is going up and down and why. In some ventilators, we don't see the bilious. Not seeing the bilious means that, doesn't mean that there is no ventilator. It is there, existing somewhere in the machine. I will show you where is it. Some older ventilators are beyond the mechanism of the traditional ventilators. I will explain in two types of these old ventilators. The one on the left is called the Manley Palmer vent. This one, when we started our practice earlier, more than 40 years ago, it was the only available ventilator. its action is simply by taking the outflow of the what we call fresh gas. We adjust the fresh gas flow through the flow meter. What is coming from the flow meter is going to pass through the vaporizer, then coming out of the fresh gas outlet. There is a hose beyond this ventilator. We'll take the hose and attach it to outlet of the fresh gas flow. All the minute volume will come inside the ventilator, and it is called minute volume divider. It will divide this minute volume. For example, if it is 8 liters, I will adjust the rate. First, there is one knob for the edge sheeting on and off, the other one for the rate. When I make it 12 per minute, the rate, it will divide the minute volume on this number of or frequency of breeze per minute, and this will result in the tidal volume. So if it is, if the minute volume is 6 liters, adjusted by the flow meter, and here I will start, it will go up and down, and the reading here will show the tidal volume. The reading will show the resulting tidal volume. I will increase or decrease to show more tidal volume or less tidal volume. Let us go to the video to see how it is working. The grading here shows the tidal volume. And these hoses are the circuit, breathing circuit, with a white piece at the end. This is very simple. Now, during spontaneous breathing without using the ventilator, if the patient starts to be apneic, or if I'm giving muscle relaxant or sedative or deep anesthesia, there will be no spontaneous breathing or minimal spontaneous breathing. When I want to assist the ventilation, I will close the APL valve, partly closing the APL valve. Then I will use my hand to squeeze the reservoir bag. Squeezing the reservoir bag with my hand mimics the anesthesia ventilator. But here with the ventilator, I have to find something to replace my hand. That is the power of the ventilator, driving power. And what replaces the reservoir bag is the chamber of the bellows inside the chamber. So replacing this one of assisted ventilation or manually controlled ventilation will result in using the ventilator. Instead of my hand, something here, the driving gas, I will explain it later. The driving gas is inside the house or the chamber to squeeze the bellows down. This bellows is the reservoir bag in another form. To understand the motive bar, before we were using the ventilators as only pneumatical power. Pneumatical means using the fresh gas flow to operate the ventilator. Now, more electrical devices and electronic are coming to change the how do the ventilators work. This is the power or the motive power. The mechanism of action depends on understanding the respiratory cycle. The respiratory cycle consists of two parts, the inspiratory phase and the expiratory phase. But something should happen to change from inspiration to expiration or from expiration to expiration, that is cycling. Cycling from inspiration to expiration is called expiratory cycling, and cycling from expiration to inspiration is called inspiratory cycling. The four basic variables to operate the ventilator and to do this cycling depends on four components. The four components are, or four variables are, time, volume, pressure, and flow. You will see later how we apply these all four variables to operate the ventilator. This graph represents the respiratory cycle. It is a circle. The yellow part of the circle represents the inspiratory phase, and the blue one represents the expiratory phase. And here we can see cycling from inspiration to expiration, and here we can see cycling from expiration to inspiration. Sometimes this yellow arrow representing the inspiration is shortened a bit, and there is a pause or silence. The pause between the end of inspiratory flow, the yellow one, to the beginning of the blue one, the expiration, is called inspiratory pause. Inspiratory pause, or end inspiratory pause, or inspiratory hold, at which the ventilator stops flow, and something will happen. I will see later what happens. So the inspiratory time here consists of two parts: the inspiratory flow part, that is the yellow one, and the inspiratory hold or inspiratory pause, the transparent one here. This part is important. I will see later what does it represent. The relationship of the ventilator to the breathing system, I said before that it replaces the reservoir bag in the breathing system. Here the two boxes perpendicular to each other are a graph representing the ventilator. It may be connected, this ventilator may be connected to the breathing system, to the machine using a hose. And these are the old ventilators or older versions. This hose is attached to the anesthesia machine through a bag mount in some ventilators like the Penlon, the Nuffield. I will explain later, or be connected to the ventilator bag selector valve. This ventilator bag selector valve, when I start ventilation, I will push the or touch the button of on ventilator on. Then in this type of ventilator, I have to change or select or to move this switch to the V or ventilator action. So I will choose either bag to the right side here or ventilator to the left side here. So the ventilator is connected to the machine. In newer versions, there is no hose. So we stopped this step. We don't handle the hose to connect or to be connected to the anesthesia machine. In all versions, we have to do this step. Now it is shortened to minimize the fallacies. So we only start having the ventilator on. We don't need to connect a hose. But in many of the new ventilators also, I have to change this selector to switch between ventilator or bag. During mechanical ventilation, the APL valve here, the APL valve, adjustable pressure limiting valve, that I use to adjust by switching or by moving clockwise or anti-clockwise to increase the pressure inside, to minimize leakage, to assist the ventilation. Now this APL valve is essential to manual ventilation, so using the reservoir bag. But now in the ventilator, when I start the mechanical ventilation, the APL valve in the breathing circuit or breathing system must be closed or isolated in according to the type of the ventilator. I will show later in which ventilators we have to close. But almost all anesthesia, the available ventilators now, I will not touch. It is isolated, automatically isolated. Once I start mechanical ventilation, the APL valve is isolated. Don't touch this APL valve. Don't try to open or close. It has no function. Whenever I start mechanical ventilation on, okay, don't be busy or don't mind with the APL valve. It is isolated. Most selector valves in which we select either bag or ventilator, When turn it for mechanical ventilation, isolate the APL valve and no need to close. These are examples for showing the APL valve here. This is the old Dräger ventilator. The APL valve is here. And the bag ventilator switch, move to the left or right, it will show it is either bag or auto. Another type, it is here, bag or ventilator. This is a switch or selector. And this one is the APL valve. Whenever I start ventilation, the APL valve is isolated and we need to touch it. Here, this is the Datex Omega or General Electric ventilator. This is a recent one. This is the selector. It is, simply shows two symbols of manual ventilation. So this is a bag or automatic. This is a ventilator. And APL valve is isolated here also. When I demonstrate this diagram, it appears like a complicated one, but I will simplify to understand how the gas is supplying the ventilator to operate it. We have two sources of gas, of oxygen, coming to the anesthesia ventilator. Here, from this point, all this area is the anesthesia, inside the anesthesia machine. This slide shows the flow arrangement of two gas supplies. In this example, is oxygen and nitrous oxide. And many ventilators now without, or anesthesia machine without nitrous oxide, it is replaced with air. So the two gases are oxygen, nitrous oxide, or oxygen air. Of course, nitrous oxide is an anesthetic, and it is used to help in minimizing the inhalation anesthetics, and it should be mixed with oxygen. So there is some device here inside to arrange this relationship between oxygen and nitrous oxide. Now, we stopped in Egypt, for example, we stopped, or if it is not available, nitrous oxide, we use air to be used to minimize or to adjust the concentration of oxygen. So for oxygen, we have two sources, the pipeline and the oxygen cylinders, the E-size oxygen cylinder attached to the anesthesia machine. This is for safety to be used as a reserve oxygen supply. Whatever we use, either pipeline or oxygen cylinders, is coming into the anesthesia machine after being or after having its pressure reduced. The pipeline pressure, when it starts, the pipeline, when it starts inside in the oxygen bank, we use big oxygen cylinders in which the pressure, oxygen pressure is 137 bar or 137 atmosphere, the pressure inside. There in the oxygen bank, we have pressure reducing valves to reduce the pressure from 137 to 4 bar only. This 4 bar is a range from 3 to 6 or 3 to 7 or 4 to 6. So I will not mention again this range. I will use the usual pressure is the 4 bar pressure. So in the anesthesia, in the oxygen bank, it is 137 inside the cylinders. It will be reduced to 4 bar. This 4 bar oxygen will go throughout the hospital to the ER, to the ICU, to the wards, and to the OR. Coming to the OR, it is 4 bar. We have a pressure gauge to know that it is 4. It will come inside. If we use the oxygen cylinders inside the anesthesia machine or attach it to it, we also have the pressure reducing valve to change from the higher to the lower, that is 4 bar pressure. So coming inside the anesthesia machine here, we have oxygen under the pressure of 4 bar. This 4 bar pressure is used for four areas. Number one is the oxygen flush valve. Number two is the oxygen supply low pressure alarm. If it goes down in a certain level, it will give alarm. The third one is the anesthesia ventilator. So the pressure is 4. Coming here, 4. Going to the oxygen valve, it is a flush valve, it is activated. And passing through the oxygen supply low pressure alarm. And going to the anesthesia ventilator. And here, if we use nitrous oxide, we go through the fail-safe valve to manipulate or to estimate or to arrange for the relationship between oxygen and nitrous oxide. It is beyond the scope of our lecture. Then the oxygen under the pressure of 4, after being used by all these 4 devices inside the CZ machine, it will go through the second stage oxygen pressure regulator to reduce the pressure again from 4 bar to about 1 bar. This 1 bar pressure will go to the flow meters, oxygen under the pressure of 1 bar, then to the vaporizers, taking the inhalation anesthetic or the volatile anesthetic vapor, then comes out of the fresh gas outlet. So we call it here the fresh gas. The fresh gas is the gas, either oxygen only, or oxygen mixed with nitrous oxide, or oxygen mixed with air. It is now, after passing this part, it is called the fresh gas. What is below or before going to the second stage pressure regulation is called the living gas, or the oxygen pressure of 4 bar. The part going to the anesthesia ventilator is called the driving gas. The part going to the flow meters is called the fresh gas. This fresh gas will take the anesthesia vapor and will come out of the fresh gas outlet. So this opening that we call fresh gas outlet, that's sometimes not seen. It is connected automatically to the rest of the machine, or it is seen. As I said before, either I connect a hose from the ventilator to the fresh gas outlet, or just change the selector from this opening to close or to open. If we don't have this hose to operate the ventilator, we select only the ventilator on, so this opening will be deactivated. Now we have 3 levels of pressure. The one on the left side is the high pressure, the yellow area, 137. The one in white or the middle is the intermediate pressure of 4 bar. And the one in green is the low pressure around 1 atmosphere or 1 bar. This is the area of the fresh gas flow. Again, this is the same one in another form, cylinders, pipelines, then machine, and the outlet. We can see on the side or the back of any anesthesia machine the operating pressure. Of course, you know the transformation from any unit of pressure. As you know, you have many units. The SI1 is a kilopascal. Here we see the oxygen is 260 to 600 kilopascal. This means 2.6 to 6 atmosphere or bar. Multiply by 100 to have it in kilopascal. We have opening for the oxygen, for air, and for nitrous oxide. And each one, it is written there, the operating pressure. This symbol, whenever we see this icon, it is for pipeline. This one is pipeline, and this one is for cylinders. So there should be not a cylinder, but it's not available here. So the opening is closed. And we should have oxygen cylinder, the reserve one, but unfortunately it is not here. If it is there, it will be connected through this opening. Again, the same, it is here the pressure in this another machine. It is 2.8 to 6. Bar, this is cylinder, or 2.8 to 6 bar, this is a pipeline. Of course, we know the color coding. This one is for oxygen, the white one, and this black one, or black and white, it is for air. Again, the same. These are the pressure units. showing or displaying the pressure inside the this connection coming from the pipeline and different forms of measuring the pressure. Here it is 2.6 to 6.9 bar. I said before how we transform it to kilopascal or PSI, that is the pound per square inch, pound per divide by 14.7 to have this reading. One bar equals one atmosphere equals 100 kilopascal equals 14.7 PSI. This area shows where we connect the reserve oxygen cylinders that are not present here, but it is connected through this area that's called gas yoke. We have two gas yokes, oxygen, two for oxygen and two for nitrous oxide. It is connected here. This one is coming from the pipeline. So to understand how the ventilator works, I will go to the back of the ventilator. This is the ventilator. It consists of two parts. The one down, this rectangle is called the control unit. And the one up, that is vertical unit, is a bellows assembly. To understand the operation, I am back now on the back of the ventilator to show that oxygen supply is coming from the pipeline here in this white hose. It comes inside with the pressure I described before. It will go inside. We adjust the ventilator settings, I will see later. Operate the ventilator. The ventilator will give its output as a tidal volume. Let us say it is 500 ml of oxygen. It will come through this black connection. So this oxygen under pressure of 4 will come inside. According to the settings, it will give output. This output consists of tidal volume that will be given interrupted by the, according to the rate that I have adjusted. So if it is 10 times per minute, so in 1 minute, the oxygen will come inside this one 10 times in a minute with 500 ml of oxygen. This oxygen will come, will go into the rigid housing here to compress the bellows down. So oxygen is only used here to be in 4 bar pressure. Its function is only to compress or to squeeze the bellows down. When we squeeze the bellows down, the contents of the bellows inside, we call it patient gas, it will go through into the inspiratory limb of the breathing circuit. So the red one is called the driving gas, that is pure oxygen under pressure of 4 bar. Its function is only to squeeze the bag down, and the bag when it's squeezed down, its content will come through the inspiratory limb of the, or to the inspiratory limb of the breathing circuit. And here it is the breathing, or the patient gas. It is represented here by the green arrow. So we have two types of gas. The driving gas, that is oxygen under pressure, and the patient gas, that is the content of the patient's lung that came out of the lungs during the expiration, will come through the expiratory limb, will come inside the bellows to expand it. This is the one of the essential points to understand how do the ventilators work. Driving gas under pressure. Its function is to compress the gas, the bellows from inside the rigid housing. The content, that is the patient gas, that is only the expired gas, and it is not mixed with oxygen. The driving gas and the patient gas don't mix. They don't mix. This one only compresses, and this one will come to and from the patient. So it is alternating from the ventilator to the patient and from the patient to the ventilator. Here it is a simple diagram to show that this one is the bellows assembly. The set volume from the control unit will be delivered. It will compress the bellows down, and the contents of the bellows will go to the patient lung. These are the same like before, but it was different numbers. Now I'll take this ventilator to be represented as a diagram to understand more detail. This is a control unit, and this one is called rigid bellows assembly. Consists of two parts: rigid housing or chamber, some type of hard plastic, and what is inside is the bellows that is compressible. This control unit will show many areas to adjust or the parameter of ventilation, and this one I will go for more detail. Now this red dots represent the driving gas, and the green ones represent the patient gas. This opening is coming to the inspiratory of the breathing circuit, and again connected to the expiratory. This driving gas comes from the control unit. Here it passes into the rigid housing. To pass, we have to have a valve. To operate the ventilator, we need the action of four valves. The number one is called the flow valve. Number two is exhaust valve. Number three is the safety relief valve. Number four is the spill valve. According to the source of your knowledge, the names of these valves is very variable. For each valve, we may have 15 or 20 names, but I choose here only these displayed names to show. It depends here, whatever the name, it depends. It shows the function of each valve. So first one is the flow valve. This flow valve will be open at the start of inspiration. It allows passage of the driving pressure, driving oxygen under pressure, will go through the flow valve. It will fill the housing to compress the bellows down. So this valve will close at the end of inspiration. It opens at the start of inspiration to fill the housing, and then to be closed at the end of inspiration. Compressing the bellows down will result in moving the patient gas into the breathing circuit. At the end of inspiration, all valves are closed. The driving gas will fill the rigid housing fully, and the bellows will be compressed at its end, fully compressed. The housing is fully filled with driving gas, and this bellows is fully compressed, and its contents are already into the patient lung. The four valves are closed. Whenever the pressure increases at any time of the breathing cycle, there is a valve called overpressure or safety relief valve to vent the excess pressure. So this one will open if the pressure exceeds the one I adjusted during adjustment of the parameters of ventilation. Usually we adjust it to 40 or 35 centimeter water. So when the airway pressure reaches this 40 or 35 centimeter water, because the patient is coughing or whatever the reason, we'll see later, the oxygen here, the driving gas, that is pure oxygen, will come out through the safety relief valve or overpressure valve into the atmosphere. It is pure oxygen and there is no pollution. It doesn't need to go to the... I will stop for some time. Dr. Zafer, ahlan wa sahlan bi hadratak. معلش انا بقدم محاضره زوم بس استاذنك هكلمك بعد ما اخلص. شكرا شكرا شكرا. I'm sorry. And now the oxygen coming outside doesn't need to go to the scavenging system. When we start the expiration, the gas was there at the end of inspiration in the patient's lung. Then with start of expiration, it will come back from the to the expiratory limb. It will expand the bellows up. By expanding the bellows up, this driving gas needs to be vented. So it will go to the exhaust valve. So this exhaust valve will be opened by the start of expiration. It will get the driving gas outside into the atmosphere. It is pure oxygen and no pollution. And it will close at the end of expiration. So this one, the flow valve, will be utilized during the whole inspiratory time. The overpressure valve will be utilized whenever we reach the maximum pressure allowed. And the exhaust valve will open during the whole period of expiration to get the gas, the driving gas, outside into the atmosphere to let this one be without any gas if the bellows is fully expanded. This is the situation. This is a situation at the end of expiration. So we know about the flow valve, the overpressure valve, and the exhaust valve. They close at the end of expiration, of the end of inspiration, at the end of inspiration. All are closed whenever the pressure is within the range, normal range. And by reaching the end of expiration, the pressure here, when it reaches 2 to 4 centimeter water, will allow the spill valve to be open to get the excess patient gas. We know how it is excess. Not all the gas coming into the bellows will be vented through the spill valve, only the excess. To understand what is excess, I need a few slides to explain it. Now this one will go up to get all the expired tidal volume to expand it and reach the tidal volume reading, and the excess will go to the spill valve. Of course, it contains part inhalation anesthetics, carbon dioxide, oxygen in the air. So it is will contribute in the pollution. So it will be taken into the scavenging system. This is one of the anesthesia ventilators. This one is the rigger. We can see the spill valve here. The spill valve will get the excess patient gas. When it is fully expanded, it will come through this tubing out of the spill valve to the scavenging system. This diagram shows the function of the spill valve. We go back again to give more explanation. Here's the spill valve area. This orange one is the disc that is going up and down to open and to close the opening of the spill valve. There is a pilot tube here that is attached from the top of the spill valve to the rigid housing. So during inspiration, part of the driving gas will go through this pilot tubing to give pressure here in the spill valve. So the driving gas here will be represented through this small tubing to compress the disc of the spill valve to close it during inspiration. So during inspiration, the pressure is positive. It is whatever the reading. So it is this one, it will be closed and the patient gas cannot come outside the spill valve. When the inspiration stops, so there is no, and the driving pressure or the driving gas comes out through the exhaust valve, no positive pressure here, and this one is released. So it can be, it can go up by the patient gas during expiration. When we see the reading of the airway pressure, at a certain part near the end of expiration, it reaches a value before reaching 2 to 0 centimeter water at the end of inspiration, before reaching the end of expiration, at the area between 2 to 4 centimeter water till zero, this one will open to vent the excess expired gas. This table summarizes the function of the four valves, the opening time of each one, the closure time, what is gas coming, and where is the fate of this gas. The flow valve will start to be open at the start of inspiration. It will close at the end of inspiration. It vents the driving gas, that's oxygen under pressure, into the rigid housing to compensate. The exhaust valve is throughout the inspiratory expiratory time, start of expiration. At the end of expiration, it will close. The driving gas comes out and there is no pollution through it, so it goes to the atmosphere. The spill valve will be opened when the whenever the pressure inside the rigid housing is 2 to 4 centimeters. It will close at the start of inspiration. The patient's gas comes through it into the scavenging system, and the safety relief valve opens whenever the pressure reaches the setting that I adjusted at 40 or 35 or whatever. It will allows the driving pressure, the driving gas to come outside into the atmosphere. Here are the valves and some type of ventilator. The tubing that I explained before. Now this diagram or this figure shows the relationship of the ventilator to the fresh gas flow. This one is also important. This red spot represents the ventilator, and this yellow spot represents the fresh gas outlet. This one shows what is the relation between the ventilator and the fresh gas flow. As I said before, the pressure inside the anesthesia machine is 4 bar or 4 atmosphere. It will operate the ventilator. What's coming from the ventilator, that is the tidal volume, will go through this tubing. It will bypass this area because the switch valve is switching to the ventilator. If we switch to the back, nothing is coming from the ventilator. We can operate the manual ventilation here by adjusting the APL valve or the adjustable pressure limiting valve and the reservoir bag by my hand to squeeze it. The gas will come through this way. But whenever start mechanical ventilation, this switch valve will be directed to the ventilator. So this area will be isolated. And the output coming from the ventilator will come to the breathing circuit. At the start of the breathing circuit, I can see the pressure. Now the breathing circuit here is consists of many parts, starting from the inspiratory valve, inspiratory limb, the Y piece, the expiratory limb, the expiratory valve, and this one comes takes the gas to be again handled into the ventilator, and during expiration, it will go to fill the pillows. And again, during inspiration, it will be pushed, what is coming from the ventilator and what is here, to be pushed into the inspiratory limb again. So through this journey, it will come to the carbon dioxide absorber to get rid of the carbon dioxide. So the carbon dioxide absorber is a part of this circle. It is important to absorb the carbon dioxide. So what is fresh gas flow? The gas coming into the flow meter with a pressure of 1 atmosphere after passing into the vaporizer, it will take the inhalation anesthetic or the volatile anesthetic vapor. And what's coming out of the fresh gas outlet will go to join what is coming from the ventilator. So what's coming from the ventilator is gas that filled the bellows during expiration. It will expand the bellows. During inspiration, the bellows is compressed, and what is coming here is the patient gas. Carbon dioxide will be absorbed. Then again, it will come into the inspiratory. At this point, the fresh gas flow will join. So what is going into the patient's lung consists of two parts. The tidal volume coming from the ventilator and the fresh gas flow coming from the fresh gas outlet. So these two components will mix together. I said before that for the action of the ventilator, there is no mixing between the driving gas and the patient gas. Here only, this mixing occurs because of the gas coming from the fresh gas flow. To operate the ventilator, we don't need the fresh gas flow to operate. If we stop completely the fresh gas, I mean, if we close the flow meter to zero, the ventilator will work. Its action will not be affected. It will work. But the gas coming into the inspiratory loop is only the gas coming from the patient lung. The patient lung coming to the ventilator, again, coming to the patient lung, without having fresh gas flow if I close it. So the operator, the ventilator will be operated. It will work. Nothing will be affected at all. But two things will happen. There is no oxygen supply to the patient, so the patient will be hypoxic. And there is no inhalation anesthetic, so the patient will be aware. So stopping the fresh gas flow, the closing the flow meter, will not affect the ventilator function, but it will deprive the patient from oxygen and the inhalation anesthetic. Again, to simplify, this is the ventilator here, compressed, the bellows is compressed. This is during inspiration. This shaded area is isolated. It will come into the inspiratory limb through the absorber. Then the fresh gas flow will come to join the outlet of the ventilator. It will pass through the inspiratory limb of the breathing circuit into the patient's lung. During expiration, the reverse will occur. So what's coming from the patient's lung during expiration will go to the expiratory limb of the breathing circuit. This one will be open. It will come into the ventilator to fill the breathing, the bellows. The bellows will expand. And when the pressure reaches 2 to 4 centimeter water, it will be expelled through the spill valve outside. This is the pilot tube that works during inspiration to close the spill valve. The previous one here, the spill valve is closed because of this high pressure during inspiration, high driving pressure, and during expiration the pressure is low, so the spill valve will open to prevent the spill valve. So what is called excess gas flow said before, that is the gas that is coming through the fresh gas flow to be added to the outlet of the ventilator or the output of the ventilator to expand the patient lungs. But during expiration, this bellows will expand only according to the preset tidal volume. So what is added will be mixed with the patient gas and will be filled here, will be filling the reservoir bag. And what is excess? The tidal volume plus the fresh gas flow. So there is excess. This will expand according to the tidal volume. So the excess will go to the spill valve. So in a system with no significant leaks, the amount of gas that is vented by the spill valve should approximate the incoming fresh gas flow. So simply I can calculate what is coming by subtracting the fresh gas flow plus the tidal volume minus the expired tidal volume. So that should be equal to the fresh gas flow. Again, in a different way, Now I finished the main aim of my lecture today, but I still have 7 minutes. According to you, please, Dr. Saad or Dr. I'm sorry, Dr. Assam. If there is any question that is available, I can I can explain or answer, or I can go to the next point. Now, the control to control the parameters of the ventilators, I have many settings. We call settings of the ventilator or parameters of ventilation. These parameters consist of FiO2, that is the fraction of inspired oxygen or oxygen concentration, the tidal volume or VT, the frequency or the respiratory rate, the minute volume, the IA ratio, that is the relationship between inspiration, inspiratory time and expiratory time, and the inspired fresh gas flow rate. Inspired flow rate. In any ventilator, it is not necessary to have all these parameters displayed. The ventilator settings may contain only part of these 6 points, but I have to know the remaining that are not displayed. For example, here in this police ventilator, I have on and off, standby, on and off, adult and electric. Here the parameters are only tidal volume, frequency, and IA ratio. No minute volume. Simply, the minute volume is multiplication of the tidal volume times the frequency. Multiplying this one by this one will result in minute volume. And IA ratio can increase and decrease to reach the intended ratio here, that is 1 to 2 here. And the pressure limiting here is, for example, is here in this display is 37 centimeter water. This display shows the airway pressure. So what I said before, there is no adjustment of the FiO2. There is no adjustment of the minute volume. It is only simply it is a multiplication. The oxygen concentration, I can adjust by through the flow meter to mix oxygen with air according to the concentration that is required. In this ventilator, Omida 7000, I have the on and off. Here the parameters are only minute volume, rate, and IA ratio. So here there is no tidal volume, but simply I can divide this reading of minute volume, divide it by the rate to have the tidal volume delivered. In this ventilator, that is Narcomed Dräger, we have additional display for inspiratory flow. I will explain later, not today, next lecture, inshallah. Here we can see what is called inspiratory pause to inspiratory time ratio. Inspiratory pause, I said before in the first, very early in this lecture, what is pause, that is inspiratory hold or pause at which the ventilator stops to give flow to the patient. This is part of the inspiration. This part, as a part of inspiratory time, it is represented as percentage. So inspiratory pause, when we say it is 10, it is 10% of the total inspiratory time. The total inspiratory time consists of the inspiratory flow time in which the ventilator gives its flow. Then it will stop for a fraction of a second. This fraction of the second of a second is called the inspiratory pause. There is no flow. It is represented as percent of the total time of the inspiratory part of the respiratory cycle. Here the parameters are simply operation. Here the adjustment according to the maximum pressure, tidal volume, frequency, IA ratio, respiratory boost time, and PEEP. This one is Dräger also, Cicero. I can see these parameters, mode of ventilation here, parameters as I explained before. So the all parameters can be seen or adjusted to give the all the settings without having all the parameters, but I can simply calculate or to be displayed only. Here we cannot see the tidal volume in this one that is dummy cabin ventilator. I can adjust on and off, the tidal volume with no reading here, but I increase or decrease, and the C in the bellows assembly at the grading there, how much is the tidal volume displayed on the grading in the bellows or bellows assembly. So there are markings there to see what is the volume. By increasing and decreasing in this button, I can have the intended or the preset tidal volume to be delivered to the patient. This one displays the pressure and this one the rate. So there is no mean volume here. Multiply this rate, this one rate, multiplied by the volume delivered and seen on the display to give the mean volume. I ratio is here, and this is the maximum pressure allowable of respiratory pressure, peak respiratory pressure. Here it is adjusted as the peak is 40, and it will not go down below 10. So this is a display of the pressure. And this one is the actual pressure measured, it's 27 here. The anesthesia pinlon ventilator has two forms, the traditional one of the ascending bellows, and this is will be the last to show today. We call this one pinlon nuffled. As I said before, most of the lecture will be directed to the traditional ventilators that I have explained already. And I showed the manly ventilator, how it works, the minute volume defender. The other one of all the ventilators here is the pinlon nuffled. It has nothing to related to what I explained before for the traditional ventilators, but here we can see the assembly. This is a coaxial circuit or the vein circuit. There are two tubes for inspiration and expiration. And we remove the reservoir bag that is attached here, remove the reservoir bag and connect the hose coming from the ventilator. I have to fully close the APL valve to avoid leakage from this outlet. The fresh gas is essential to be so the opening here will be activated to have the breathing circuit attached to it. And what is coming from the ventilator will go, and it will be mixed with the fresh gas at this point to go to the patient. To adjust the ventilator settings here, I have, after this on and off one, I have three buttons, one for the inspiratory time, one for the expiratory time, and one for the flow, the flow rate. The flow rate, that is what is the tidal volume divided by inspiratory time. The preset or the adjusted tidal volume divided by the inspiratory time. So the flow rate is a volume per time. If I, for example, if I give, for example, 1 liter, tidal volume in 1 second inspiratory time. So the flow rate is 1 liter per second. If I give 0.5 liter in 1 second, it is 0.5 liter per second, the flow rate. So to adjust, simply, if I need a rate of 20 per minute. So 20 per minute means the minute is 60 seconds. 60 seconds divided by 20 means that the respiratory cycle is 3 seconds. So I want the respiratory cycle to be 3 seconds times 20 frequency, it will fill the minute. So simply adjusting this one added to this one, the sum is the respiratory cycle. Divide 60 by this sum, it will give the rate. So there is no button here to give the rate. It is simply dividing 60 over the sum of inspiratory time and expiratory time that is respiratory cycle. 60 divided by respiratory cycle time gives the rate. If I want the rate to be 20, so this one will be 3 seconds in addition. This one added to this one. If I want the ratio to be 1 to 2, I will adjust the inspiratory time to be 1 second. 1 second here by moving this up and down, or clockwise and clockwise. 1 second, 2 seconds expiration. The sum is 3, so the rate will be 20. The remaining one is the fresh, the flow rate. Flow rate. So I have now the inspiratory time, 1 second. If I want the tidal volume to be 1 liter, for example, I will adjust this flow rate to be one liter. 1 liter in 1 second, the flow rate will be, the tidal volume will be 1 liter. Now I want the tidal volume to be 0.5 liter. And the inspiratory time is 1 second. So I need 0.5 liter, the tidal volume, in 1 second, that inspiratory time. So I will adjust the flow rate to 0.5. 0.5 means this ventilator will deliver 0.5 liter in 1 second. So this 0.5 will be divided by the inspired time. So it will be, in this example, 500 milliliter each time. I will stop here because only now it is 1 hour. Thank you.
Prof. Raafat, just one comment for this type of lectures. And I think all of us, we know that physics is very difficult.
Yeah.
And it is this chapter of physics in anesthesia is the most difficult chapter for the seniors and the juniors. And it needs a lot of understanding and a lot of interest, of course. It should be understood very well. And the person who is delivering the lecture or understanding this, he should be interested in the field of the physics. And all of us, we face a lot of difficulties while we are going for studying the physics. And I know that a lot of audience, they consider it is boring, but it is basic for the anesthesia. And we just started with the first step, and the first important step in the ventilator. So I recommend and advise all of us and our juniors to just read and to take some knowledge about this series of lectures before coming to attend these lectures, to know about the feedback and to know about this knowledge before coming. I know also there are no more questions in this type of lectures because we have series of lectures. And I think at the end of the series of the lectures, we will collect a lot of questions. But please, Prof, consider me as a junior resident. And I want to ask you, yani, I put myself in a position of the R1 in anesthesia, and he is coming for the theaters. And if I, for example, just simple question, if I am confronted with disconnection of the anesthesia circuit, for example, there is an inspiratory limb and expiratory limb. What will happen if it is, I put the inspiratory in the expiration and I put the expiratory in the inspiratory limb? Is there any difference?
No, there is no difference at all. I have the circuit in my hands. Whatever you have in your right hand connected to the inspiratory output or outlet, and the one on the left hand, put it in the expiratory or the reverse. Nothing will happen at all. It is simply a tubing, yeah.
Okay, so this is for the juniors. There is no difference to put the inspiratory in the expiratory and the expiratory in the inspiratory.
Of course, yeah.
Okay, for the vaporizers,
yeah,
we know that we had old one, halocyane, and the recent one, sevoflurane and isoflurane and disflurane. And I think in the next lectures, you will speak in details about this vaporizer and how it works and the effect of the flow on this delivery of these agents. And as you mentioned, Prof, there is no more use of nitrous oxide nowadays in our machine. We are using instead the analgesia by the intravenous anesthetics, intravenous analgesics, either short acting or long acting opioid, right, Prof?
Yes, of course. I am talking regarding this point of nitric oxide. It is stopped in Egypt. I am against this stoppage, but we have to face this this one. So in Egypt, we don't use nitric oxide because it is not available. The manufacturers of anesthesia machines adjusted their manufacturing to give machines without nitrous oxide.
Okay.
But we can use air to adjust the concentration of oxygen.
In the next series, I think, Prof, you will speak also about the difference between the anesthesia machines and the ventilator in the ICU, right?
Yeah. I presented before with Dr. Saad and Dr. Waleed Habashi, the ventilation in critical inpatient. It is a different subject, but many of the points that I will explain here are applied also to the patient in the critical care unit, but I focus here on how the anesthesia ventilator work. Of course, we will go to the clinical points of how the respiratory cycle is completed. This is common between ICU and anesthesia.
Okay, Prof. We have two questions, Prof, from our audiences. The first one, is there a benefit from an inspiratory pause in the anesthesia machine?
Yes. It will later, I'll explain later some part in the presentation number three or four. I will explain it.
Okay.
Let us wait. Now I started with the basic principles, physical principles of how the ventilator is working. Now, later on, I will merge the clinical application with what I said.
Okay. If you don't mind, Prof, another question asking about, please, can you repeat how to calculate the the flow rate in Penlon ventilator and the inspiratory time?
Yes, please. I will share again my screen. I have three parts: inspiratory time, expiratory time, and flow rate. There is no knob for respiratory cycle time total. There is no one for the respiratory rate. But as we know, the respiratory cycle consists of two parts: inspiratory time and expiratory time. When I add simple addition, inspiratory time plus expiratory time, this is a respiratory cycle. So if it is 1 second inspiration and 2 seconds expiration, so the cycle is 3 seconds. So how many cycles will be given in a minute? Divide 60 by 3, it is 20. So the rate here is 20 because the sum of inspiration plus expiration is 3. If I want a rate of 10, I will make the inspiratory time 2 seconds, expiratory time 4 seconds. The sum will be 6 seconds. Divide 60 by 6, it will be the rate will be 10. So how to adjust the rate? Divide 60 by the sum of inspiratory time and expiratory time. Now let us divide this respiratory cycle time into two components, inspiration and expiration. If I want the ratio to be 1-to-1, like I'll say later on, why to give 1-to-1, why to give 1-to-2, why to give 2-to-1, simply here in a healthy person, the ratio will be 1-to-2. So for the rate of 20, the inspiratory time, I will adjust it to 1 second, expiratory time will be 2 seconds. Together are 3 seconds, 60 seconds in a minute, divided by 3, will give a respiratory cycle of 20 per minute. Now, I want the tidal volume to be adjusted. This is only the inspiratory time, expiratory time, the relationship, and the respiratory rate. Now, to adjust the tidal volume. As I said before, tidal volume simply is what is given in a unit time. What is given in a unit time? The unit time here, if it is only 1 second, so what is adjusted in the flow rate will be simply the tidal volume. For example, if I adjust the tidal volume to be 1 second, whenever I increase or decrease, this is the tidal volume. The delivered volume is the flow rate. Rate means volume per time. Volume per time. So if I adjust this one, the flow rate bottom, to be half, means half liter per second. If the inspiration time is 1 second, so half liter will be delivered in 1 second. So the tidal volume will be half liter. Suppose that I want to give a tidal volume of 750. So I will adjust this one to be the flow rate to be 0.75 liter per second. It will give 750 milliliter in 1 second. By simple calculation, I can know how to adjust the flow rate to give the intended tidal volume. As I said before, for example, I want to give a rate of 10. Rate of 10 means the respiratory cycle is 60 seconds. 60 seconds, if I want the ratio of inspiration to expiration to be 1 to 2, so these 6 seconds will be divided into 2 seconds of inspiration and 2 seconds of expiration. The sum is 6 and the rate will be 10. In these 2 seconds, I want to give the tidal volume. So if I want to give 500 ml in 2 seconds, that is the tidal volume. So the flow rate should be one liter, 250 in a second, 250 in a second, 250 in a second. This I will adjust here, this one. I will move clockwise to be 0.25. 0.25 means a quarter of a liter in 1 second. And because the inspiratory time here in this example is 2 seconds, so each second it will be 0.25, so a quarter of a liter in 1 second, but the inspiratory time is 2 seconds, so 0.25 plus 0.25, so in 2 seconds, I will give 0.5 liter in 2 seconds, that is the tidal volume. Okay. If I am not clear, please let me re-explain.
Okay, Prof. We have another question from Professor Safa. Yeah. And it is better to invite her to Prof. Safa Hilal. You hear me? She is one of the our elegant panelists.
I am here.
Okay. Professor Welcome. Safa, Welcome. You have a question, and I prefer to deliver your question by yourself. Please go ahead.
Okay, Dr. Aysam, it's a great pleasure for me to participate now with my great professor, Dr. Raafat Abdel-Azim, a professor, Dr. Aysam. My greeting to my brother, Dr. Saad Mahdi. My question is, as regards the artificial intelligence in the new anaesthesia machine, does it will complicate the machine, or it will be used so easily and simply? What's your opinion, my great Dr. Raafat?
Thank you, Dr. Safa. You are most welcome. Your question is very important because whenever we improvement in anaesthesia machine technology will give more use of electronic units, and the display is more clear. The calculations can be displayed like resistance and compliance, as I will explain later. I will see the figures presented without needing to have a calculator. So it will give the calculations and the loops that I will explain later also. The display of the use of microprocessor has much improved the performance. But with new technologies, there are new problems, as you said. New problems that the electronic failure or electric failure may happen in a fraction of a second, and it will stop all these displays. If the electric supply and the machine is regularly maintained, and the electric supply is always there, and the machine, if any part is out of work should be replaced. So I will be happy with this more technology. But as you said, more advanced technology has its own problems.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you
very much. Yasser Reda was us. And,
thank you, Dr. Yasser. I'm happy to be with you.
Of course, he has a lot of questions in his mind. He is updated in everything. Dr. Yasser, yeah. Please.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Raafat, about this presentation. I'm really excited even. As Dr. Assam said, we don't like physics because our clinician, we don't like mathematics. If we like mathematics, we will go to be engineer. But I have a question related to Dr. Assam's question, because you speak about the basic bag technology. But the new technology was artificial intelligence. Do they have the same technology like this, pressuring oxygen or stuff like this, or have a new technology we don't declare in the presentation?
Yes, thank you very much. You are most welcome, Dr. Yasser. I'm very happy to meet you.
Thank you.
This is only one part of the presentation. It represents about 20% that I will explain. So by the end of the lectures, still, I have many areas to explore to see how the new technology has much changed our practice in dealing with the anesthesia ventilators. So just wait for the next few lectures, inshallah.
I will wait because I will be your coordinator soon, inshallah. I'm just
welcome,
proud for
inshallah.
That.
Inshallah.
And the second question, because it happened, you speak about bilum bag, and there is two different oxygen for driving force, which high pressure, pressurizing towards the patient, and separate chamber for the patient. How can we discover if the bag just perforated?
Yeah.
And two gas mixing, and this is me endangering the patient.
Yes. I'm very happy with your question. It's very important. That's why I will explain it in detail later on, inshallah. Because now I am explaining the basics. Now I will incorporate this one into the new technologies and the display of the pressures and the volumes and how we can understand. Actually, I have a lecture other than this one explaining the anesthesia machine, and how can we connect together these parts of the anesthesia machine. As Dr. Assam said before, how it is affected by the vaporizer. I have a separate lecture, not this one, a separate lecture about the safety features and understanding how the anesthesia machine works. But because of the ventilator complicated principles of physics, that's why it takes much more time to explain.
Yeah.
Forgive me for the details are summarized, but later I will, some points will be re-explained to make it more clear.
As I told you.
Thank you, just an asking in advance. Thank you very much for the answer. We are waiting just to finish the series
inshallah.
And to answer, inshallah.
Yes,
thank
inshallah.
You very much.
As I told you, Professor Abdel-Azim, Dr. Yasser, he is updated and he is asking in advance. And he will take the whole chance next
inshallah.
Week to ask what is in his mind. And he will take the floor for him. As he wants. The last question, and because I know the time is about to be over now.
Just one comment, Dr. Assam, in 1 minute.
Okay, just one question, and I'll give you the floor, Dr. Talat. One question from the audience. He's asking about nitrous oxide, as we mentioned, Professor Abdel-Azim. Why did we stop using nitrous oxide and still used in Kingdom of Saudi Arabia? Why to be stopped?
Yes, as I said before, I am against this decision. It happened because some impurities in a certain line of manufacturing the factory manufacturing the nitrous oxide, there was some fault resulted in impurities in nitric oxide that led to death of one or two patients. So instead of solving the problem of having these impurities, they decided to stop use of nitric oxide. I'm not happy with this decision. It was taken in 2009. Now we have 13 years of being deprived from use of nitric oxide. But if I go to Kingdom of Saudi Arabia or Kuwait, I'm very happy to use nitric oxide.
So it is a matter of technical issue,
yes.
not medical. Means a drug.
Yes.
And some of the drugs, you know, Prof, it came again strongly in using in anesthesia, like ketamine and nitrous oxide.
Yes.
So we hope to return back in Egypt, inshallah.
I hope.
Inshallah. Dr. Talat, you can ask what you want, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Assam. And thank you, Dr. Raafat, for your very interesting lecture, taking the basics, which all of us have a little bit latency to read the basics again. Regarding the basics for the pressure limiting valve and the anesthetic circuit, usually it's adjusted, or even in the advanced machines comes to 40.
Yeah.
My question is, the pressure limiting valve we has to manipulate or preset again, especially when we are going to anesthetize neonates and children.
Yeah.
This is the first one, yeah. The second point is the pressure, driving pressure, or the pressure in the anesthetic circuit after the control valve or the pressure regulator.
Yeah.
You told that it is one atmospheric pressure, not to
second,
be higher.
After second stage, yes.
Second stage, yes.
Yeah.
If it is one atmospheric pressure, I think there will no be flow. Because
yes, it is
as atmospheric pressure. So it is plus one atmospheric pressure, I think.
Yes. Yes, I agree with you. First, I have to welcome you. I'm very happy to meet you, Dr. Talat. Your questions are very important. I will start with the second one, the second question. You said,
yes.
If it is one atmosphere, it will not come back. Say, I agree with you. It is just one atmosphere. It is just above one atmosphere. Just
right.
above it. It is not 1.5. But it is just above one atmosphere.
Above, right.
Yeah, of course, it is logic to have it just above one atmosphere to make the flow come outside. Regarding the APL valve, we use it only with spontaneous breathing. Spontaneous breathing and manual assisted and manual control. Whenever we start mechanical ventilation, I have nothing to do with the APL valve. So if I use the APL valve to help the anesthetized person, whatever it is, adult or pediatric use. So the patient is not breathing well. He needs some assistance. This assistance, because of the muscle partly cauterized, or because of respiratory depression with the use of anesthetics or narcotics. So I have to help.
Yes.
To help, I will squeeze the bag. If the APL valve is maximally open, the pressure is atmospheric. It's zero.
Yes.
Zero related to the atmosphere. So I
no.
Have
my
to,
question, my question, yes. Dr. Raf, is not the APL valve. I mean that the driving pressure to the patient.
Sorry.
I mean that the pressure monitoring of the circuit.
Yes.
We make the maximum is 40. If it reaches more than 40, the ventilator alarms.
Well, you will stop.
Yes.
Of course,
so
I will.
Children, I think it has to be down a little bit, not 40 for neonates. And
yes, of course. Sorry for going to the APL valve. Now I remember your question. Yes, it is about the maximum allowed pressure or maximum value of an inspiratory peak pressure, peak inspiratory pressure. I will explain this in detail later on, but simply to answer your question, I can adjust this 40. To be 20, 25, 30, according to the need of the patient. If I have a patient with emphysema, for example, the lung will be very weak, and very early I can get a rupture of emphysematous bolli. So 40 is too much. In this patient, I have to consider lower values. On the other hand, if I am not intending, and it is adjusted to, say, 25, then I will start, for example, in laparoscopic surgery, after inflating the initiating pneumoperitoneum, I will reach this 25 very soon. So the tidal volume will not be delivered. So I have to increase it to 35 or 40. So also for a patient having a bronchospasm or secretions or whatever, I will reconsider. But the usual and the default is 40. I will adjust according to the patient that I have to deal with.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. At the end of this scientific night, I'd like to say that it was a great honor for me myself to share with one of the expert professors in Egypt and in the Middle East, Professor Raafat Abdel-Azim. شرف كبير لي أن أكون مديرتك.
شرف لي يا دكتور عصام أهلا بحضرتك.
I'd like to thank all the attendees and all the panelists and of course we will follow you in the next series to finish this very important course about the ventilator and I leave.